American University in Bulgaria.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I would like to thank you for coming to this event organized by the OBG Club of Political Science and the Department of Politics and European Studies. And we would also like, of course, to express our sincere gratitude to our guest speaker today, His Excellency Bunyan Sabtomo. The topic today is going to be Indonesia and Asia-Pacific region. We believe that this topic is going to bring some kind of a diversification of the studies of politics at AOBG, which have been primarily focused on Europe and North America mainly so far. The lecture is going to consist of one interesting presentation about Indonesia and the Asia-Pacific region, and after that we'll proceed with questions from the audience. But before that, let me introduce you some facts about His Excellency Bunyan Sabtomo. He was born in Klaten, Indonesia in 1957. He graduated from the Faculty of Social and Political Science in Gajah Mada University in Yogyakarta. After that, he completed the postgraduate program on international studies at Birmingham University in the United Kingdom. Since that, His Excellency has worked for the Indonesian embassies in Canberra, Australia, Hanoi, Vietnam, Beijing, China. He has been from 2005 until 2008 Indonesian Consul General in Vancouver, Canada. From 2008 until 2012, he has been he was director for North and Central American Affairs to the Ministry of Foreign Affairs of the Republic of Indonesia, and since 2012 up to the present moment, he has been ambassador extraordinary and plenipotentiary of the Republic of Indonesia to the Republic of Bulgaria and to the Republic of Albania too. So now, without further ado, I would like to give the floor to our guest speaker, His Excellency Bunyan Sabtomo.
Good afternoon. Thank you for having me here. And as mentioned here, my topic is Indonesia and Asia Pacific. It is meant to be an introduction about Indonesia. I believe only few Bulgaria know about Indonesia. The reason is because of the distance between Indonesia and Bulgaria. There are more than 10,000 kilometers from Bulgaria to Indonesia, and there are no direct flight, so this means only few Bulgaria understand about Indonesia. So it is mainly for the introduction of Indonesia, but we also would like to introduce about Indonesian relation with the region Asia Pacific and also with the world. And I would like to show you about the map of Indonesia. Now we are here in Bulgaria, and Indonesia is here far away from Bulgaria. But from the map, you will see that it is a very large archipelago. And the fact it is the largest archipelago in the world. The distance from the western tip to the eastern tip is about 5,000 kilometers. So it is similar from Western Europe to Moscow or to Ukraine. And because of a large area and also it is also archipelago in nature, so there are also very diverse community in Indonesia. It is Indonesia enlarged. As you see in the previous map, it is between continent of Asia and Australia, and also between Pacific Ocean and Indian Ocean. So the location is very strategic, and the crossroad. Since 1,000 years ago, it is also one of the Silk Road. It is maritime Silk Road from China. From China to the north, sorry about this. from China to the north, and then to Middle East, and then to Europe. And it is also part of not only Silk Road, but also Spicy Road, yeah, because this area, especially Eastern Indonesia, is producing spicy, clove, nutmegs, and several spicy products. I would like to show you the fact about Indonesia. As I told you that it is the largest archipelago in the world, and the population is the fourth largest in the world, to 140 million people. In terms of politics, it is the third largest democracy in the world. And in terms of economy, now Indonesia is 16 largest in the world, so that's why Indonesia now become member of G20. Sorry about that. And in terms of culture, Indonesia is multicultural society with more than 300 ethnic groups with different languages and culture. Next, we are going to talk about Indonesia in general. To understand Indonesia, we have to talk about ideology of Indonesian nation. Talking about Indonesian ideology, we can see from the coat of arms of Indonesia. It is the coat of arms of Indonesia. This symbol on the shield is the five principles of Indonesian ideology. The first principle is belief in God. The first principle, then humanity, unity, democracy, and social justice. This already in Indonesian constitution since 1945 when we got independent. And then to accommodate our diverse nature, we have motto Bhinneka Tunggal Ika. In English, it means unity in diversity, because we have to accommodate the interests of different ethnic groups, different religious groups, and also different race. Then next. It is an example of the implementation of our national ideology. The first one is because of there are different religious group. We officially have all religious group. So in Indonesia, we have a Christian religious holiday, Muslim religious holiday, Hindu, Buddhist, and other. We have so many holidays, and it makes people happy. And the second one is respect the right of ethnic groups. Example is the teaching of individual language of ethnic groups at the primary school. When I study at primary school, I learn our native language, our ethnic language. And individual ethnic groups have the right to teach their own children based on their language. And then third one is respect political and individual, respect political and individual expression. We have regular election, media freedom. And then promote social justice, including now we have education and healthcare for all. Now we come to foreign policy. After we understand about the ideology of our nations, we also have foreign policy based on our ideology. Based on our constitution, main pillar of foreign policy is anti-colonialism. It is because Indonesia was colonized more than 200 years by foreign power. And we also understand that colonization is certainly against humanity and injustice. So it is our main pillar of our foreign policy. We determine to work together with other countries to abolish colonialism. And then the second one of our foreign policy is to protect people and territory. It is common for foreign policy goal. And then the third goal is prosperity and intellectual rights. Then the fourth one is to contribute the establishment of a world order based on freedom, peace, and social justice. So it is related to the first principle in our foreign policy. So based on this principle, during the first year after independence, we must focus on working together with other countries to abolish colonialism. So in 1955, we organized Asia-Africa Conference. It's meant to help other countries in Asia and Africa to promote their independence. And we also, from 1956, we participate in peacekeeping operation. The first peacekeeping operation is in 1956 in Congo. So from that year, we continue participate until today. Today, we have more than 1,000 peacekeeping troops in Lebanon. It's a part of United Nations peacekeeping operation in this area. So that's the first one is actually more based on our ideology in our constitution, and then it is more on implementation of our ideology. Based on this ideology, and then we have free and active foreign policy. This means we free to decide our foreign policy. We did not join big power during Cold War era, and we active to promote peace around the world. And then after that, based on our experience in our region from independence until 1960s, we experienced a lot of conflict with our border, with Malaysia, with Philippines, and Malaysia with Thailand, yeah. And then Vietnam with Cambodia, Vietnam with Thailand. And then in 1967, we initiate to establish ASEAN. ASEAN is Association for Southeast Asian Nations. It is meant to promote peace in the region, in Southeast Asia, and also to promote economy. From the beginning of our independence, we jumped to international active participation. But in 1960, we realized that we should start from our region. And since the establishment of ASEAN in 1967, we managed to keep the region stable. And it is good for our economic development. And then after we established ASEAN, and then we actively develop regional architecture. It is not only in Southeast Asia, but we expand to Asia Pacific. We start from developing what we call ASEAN Plus 3, probably in this one. ASEAN Plus 3 is ASEAN plus China, Japan, and South Korea. It is talking about free and active policy. As I told you, that free and active foreign policy is developed as implementation of our ideology in our constitution. It is the definition of free to determine the future of our people, and then does not follow any power in the world, and also active in developing friendship and international cooperation. From 1967, we start from, we established, as I told you before this, we established ASEAN in 1967. Starting from this area, we gradually expand to be a cooperation of the wider region and also the world. So we expect that in 2015, we develop a full ASEAN community. And then further architecture, we want to develop this ASEAN corner. Yeah, Indonesian in 2011 holding the chairmanship, and our priorities is to ensure significant progress of ASEAN community in 2015. And then ensuring maintenance of stable and secure region, then ASEAN community in global community of nation. It is Indonesian outlook of the regional architecture. As we start from ASEAN, ASEAN was established by 5 nations first, but now fully 10 countries in Southeast Asia region. As I told you before, and then we expanded to ASEAN plus 3, Korea, China, and Japan. And then after that, we expanded to several countries. We established East Asia Summit. It is involving United States, Russia, New Zealand, and Australia. And then we also develop APEC, Asia-Pacific Economic Cooperation. It is involving other countries also from South America, because it is the countries in Pacific region, Chile, Peru, Mexico, Canada, Hong Kong, China, Taipei, and Papua New Guinea. And then after that, we develop ASEM. This involving European Union. So it is a dialogue between European Union, 27 countries, with ASEAN plus 3, I think, Korea, China, and Japan. And then we also develop wider cooperation. It is the probably the wider one is IRF. IRF is ASEAN Regional Forum. It is a forum to discuss political and security in Asia Pacific region. So it is the outlook of Indonesia in the construction of regional architecture with purpose to maintain stability and security in Asia Pacific region, and also to build a secure and favorable atmosphere for economic development in the region. Yeah, it is already start from ASEAN, and then ASEAN plus, and other. Our concept is based on a dynamic equilibrium. It is the definition of dynamic equilibrium is the absence of domination from any countries in the region. So we always expand it in order to make the power balance in the region is equal. And then we emphasis on cooperation and constructive collaboration, not emphasis on conflict. So we promote cooperation. And then based on win-win paradigm, not zero-sum game. That's our purpose in to establish peace and also economic development in the region. Now we give you a small tip. Our title is only Indonesia and Asia Pacific region, but now we expanded to global vision of Indonesia. As it is based on our ideology, it is actively to promote global order. I told you before that we active in peacekeeping operation under United Nations. And then we also active in UN high level panel of eminent person on development. Indonesian president is the co-chair of this panel. And then we also participate actively in disarmament UN committee. And then UN Human Rights Council as member. Then in G20 and also WTO, we just host the WTO meeting in Bali, and it was successful to agree on Bali Packet. And then this year, we are going to organize UN Alliance of Civilization. And hopefully, this conference will also be produce beneficial result for global development and also global peace. So we also continue to propose UN reform because the world is developing, and certainly we also emphasis that United Nations should be reformed based on the current situation. In our diplomacy, we emphasis on soft power because Indonesia is a medium power and our military is not so powerful even compared with our neighbor. In terms of the hardware, Indonesia is very limited. So we continue emphasis on soft power in which we actively promote interfaith dialogue. And then we organize Bali Democracy Forum every year. It is meant to promote democracy in Asia Pacific region. And then we continue updates from the region. And then we also organize presidential friend of Indonesia. And then develop cooperation with other country. This short cooperation. And then we actively send cultural mission to other countries, including to Bulgaria. Last year, we sent 5 cultural mission to Bulgaria, and it is the record. Usually, we only send 1 or 2 to Bulgaria, but last year, 5. Then we also offer scholarship. The scholarship is still focus on Indonesian culture and Indonesian language. Last year, 5 Bulgarian students take this scholarship, and this year we hope more Bulgarian students interested in taking this scholarship. That's what can I said about Indonesia. It is mainly introduction about Indonesia, and I believe you read about Indonesia and Asia Pacific region, and if you have a question, and also if you have some views about Indonesia and Asia Pacific region, please don't hesitate to raise your question. Thank you very much. Thank you.
What's Indonesian view on the security situation in the Pacific region? As
I told you before, sorry, I'm sitting now. Yeah. As I told you before, when we established ASEAN in 1967, it is main goal is to promote stability in the region. So we by having ASEAN and then expanded to many organization and network, it's to promote peace in the region. So our motto is equilibrium for the region. So when we develop ASEAN plus one, and then ASEAN plus three, now ASEAN plus six, it is meant to what you call, to keep the balance in the region, because there are some power emerging so powerful, and then we need to involve other countries to make the balance of power in the region is getting more stable. So since 1967, we Indonesia very concerned about the security situation, because security is very important, security and stability important for the development of economy in the region. That's what I can say. Thank you. Yes?
Since Indonesia is a country that has vast experience with dealing with different ethnic minorities, what would be your opinion on resolving conflicts that emerge from time to time between the ethnic minority of Albanians in Serbia, for example, or on the other hand, of Greek minorities in Albania?
Yes, I think too, we have experience in creating what you call balance. Yeah. So in everyday life, Indonesia is educated to be tolerant. Certainly, for multi-ethnic and multi-culture nation, the majority should be very tolerant. In Indonesia, the ethnic majority is Javanese, but it is only 40%. As I told you, that there are more than 300 ethnic groups with different languages. So before independence, our ethnic representative gather to determine which language become national language. Certainly the majority want to be national language. But finally, after discussion in several days of conference, we chose a language of small ethnic groups. It is not Javanese language, but we chose Malay language. Malay ethnic groups is actually only a small community, less than 2% of Indonesia. But this language have already understood in several cities across the country. Probably it is similar with English language in the world now. So if you talk about, for example, in Europe, if you talk about majority, probably the majority Russian want to be national language of Europe. But finally, no, we chose the small language, English, become our common language. Thus, it is the tolerance of majority. It is needed. And also, the majority of Indonesia, in terms of religion, is Islam. But we, in deciding our national ideology, there is also meeting, several days meeting, because one group want to have Islam as ideology of nation, and then some socialists to be ideology of nation, some nationalists, some want to have democracy, and then finally we come to have five principles in ideology. If you are religion, whether it is Islam, Christian, Hinduism, Buddhism, you believe in God. And then the first ideology is belief in God. And then humanity, and then unity, democracy, and social justice. So what actually we agree as our ideology is very universal ideology. Yeah, it is recognized everywhere, not only Indonesia. So it's need the tolerance of majority, whether ethnic groups of Javanese or Islam as majority Indonesia, or race, because there are several ethnic from other countries, Indian, Arabic, Arab people, and also Chinese, also recognized in Indonesia. So in Indonesia, we have holiday, not only accommodate all religious holiday, but also ethnic holiday. We also have holiday of Chinese New Year holiday, because there are several, probably less than 2% of Chinese, but we accommodate their concern. They want to have holidays, and then we put in officially as our national holiday, and then everyone have holiday and happy, I think. So it is first reach the purpose of respecting every ethnic groups and also every religious groups. That's what I can say about Indonesia. Thank you. Yes?
The situation in Thailand has been quite unstable for a certain period of time. Do you see this phenomenon as something only internal that Thailand should deal with by itself, or that countries in the region should have more active role in solving this issue in Thailand?
Yeah. With regard to the domestic issue, certainly ASEAN have a principle in which we respect the internal solution first. If the people of this nation want to invite us to participate, and then we will participate. It is a part of ASEAN way. For example, in conflict in Indonesia, I should talk about Indonesia first. Yeah, this in conflict in Aceh, in which we agreed to invite other observer from ASEAN to observe our peace process in Aceh. Then we invite observer from other ASEAN countries, from Malaysia, Thailand, Philippines. And then finally, we were able to solve the problem in Aceh. And then if Thailand government or people invite us, then we will be happy to participate. And other example is the problem in southern Philippines. And the Philippine government invite Indonesia to participate as observer of the peace process in this area, and then we send our observer to this area. So it is a kind of family help. Yeah, we help our brothers and sisters in solving their problem. Thank you.
Thank you. Excellency, would you please tell us a little bit more about the features of economic cooperation within ASEAN? I mean, the common mechanisms, the framework, the economic framework of the.
Yeah, I think the ultimate goal of ASEAN Economic Community is establishing full ASEAN Free Trade Agreement. We have agreement of establishing ASEAN Free Trade, and we are moving gradually toward the establishment of the free trade between other countries. And we now develop what we call connectivity. Yeah, because by having more connection through air link, roads, and also ship road, and then it will be also promoting economic cooperation between our nations. Thank you.
mentioned a proposal for UN reform. Can you just briefly give us a hint about what would it look like or what would the proposal
yes. be? In brief, I can mention that the UN was established in 1945, and certainly this system is based on the power balance during that time. So especially in the UN Security Council, there are mainly developed countries member of Security Council. Only one, probably China, but now China is becoming a developed country. So Indonesia proposal is want to have more what you call justice probably, yeah, which can accommodate developing countries' interests, because developing countries now have no representative. Yeah. India is big countries, yeah, with more than 1 billion people, and now becoming emerging economy, along with Indonesia and several countries like Brazil also. So I think we should do the reform. But we should discuss until everyone agree. We know that it is a big challenge for us, yeah, to be recognized that developing countries should be accommodated in United Nations, especially in UN Security Council. That's what I can say about the reform. Yes?
Your Excellency, can you share with us perhaps a bit more about what the Indonesian embassy in Bulgaria is doing to popularize Indonesian culture in Bulgaria, especially among young people?
Yeah, thank you. We continue expanding our participation in every cultural festival in Bulgaria. As I told you, that last year was record high for our participation in Bulgaria. Before, only one or two Indonesian cultural groups coming to Bulgaria, but last year, five. And now we also saw, besides a cultural group, also student exchange participant. In front of you, there is one student from Indonesia. Actually, this year, we have five students from Indonesia participate in the student exchange program. What they do is voluntary work in here in Bulgaria. So you can explain what you do in Bulgaria. Yeah, it is a part of our English participation, not only government level but also people to people level. And then we have developed cooperation with the University of Sofia. We have Indonesian class there. Indonesian language class is established since 5 years ago. And this year, we are going to have Indonesian Corner. It is a small library of Indonesia in Sofia University. And we this year also, we are going to expand our presence in Veliko Turnovo. 2 months ago, I visited Veliko, and then I met the director of high school in Veliko, and then they agreed to have Indonesian class in this high school. It is part of our promotion of Indonesian language in Bulgaria. Indonesian language is very easy. There is no conjugation, yeah. So very easy one, yeah. So that's why the one reason why we chose Malay language as our national language, because it is very easy language. It is easily understood by the people. While the language of majority of ethnic Indonesia, this Javanese, is very complicated. There are three levels of language for royal family, and then for medium community, and then for lower ranking community. So finally, we choose the one more practical and useful for our people. Thank you. Anything else?
Yes.
In the recent, let's say, 40 years, with the developments in the world, technology and everything else, the lifestyle is becoming more and more uniform, especially in more Western societies. And it's quickly spreading throughout Eastern societies. How do you evaluate the importance of preserving the tradition and putting that tradition to your daily lifestyle? How does that go along with the uniforming of the society and the fast lifestyle that we're all slowly adapting to?
Yes, it is not only the challenge of Indonesia, I think the challenge of every nation in the world, yeah, because of the increasing communication technology and also transportation technology, so interaction between people around the world is influence each other. And then certainly there are also have a strong influence from Indonesia. There are more and more Indonesian who speak English. Yeah, they forget their native language. Yeah. For example, I have to admit that my son already forget their native language, my ethnic language. Yeah. My son only speak Indonesian language, English. Yeah, only that two language. Yeah, but it is common not only Indonesia. But the most important one is that the Constitution of Indonesia guarantee that every ethnic group in Indonesia have the right to educate their children, to learn their own language. So the state provide teacher for every ethnic language in state school. But the problem is, if in every ethnic area you have a different teaching ethnic, when I move from my ethnic group's area to other cities, and then my son had to learn different ethnic language. That's problem. Yeah, when they got homework, and then my son asked me about the language, I didn't know also. So it is part of our national problem. But the most important one is our constitution respect every ethnic groups and religious group to implement their belief and also their tradition. Thank you. Yes?
You heard what you do about cultural exchange between Bulgaria and Indonesia. Can you say a few words about economic exchange? Is there something around between the two countries? Like, we import something from you and export something from you?
Yes, in terms of economy, the level of bilateral trade is still below the capacity, I believe. Last year, the trade bilateral trade is still under $80 million U.S. dollar. I believe if the two countries know each other, so that's why last year I brought economic mission from Bulgaria. I invited several Bulgarian businessmen, 19 Bulgarian businessmen, to visit Indonesian Economic Expo in Jakarta. And after that, visit Bali also, because they want to, not only for business, but also they want to see Bali for leisure also. It is good, but by having economic mission, hopefully we will be able to develop cooperation. I told Bulgarian businessmen several times that now Indonesia is a big market with 240 million people, and with economic growth around 6%, it is certainly a very big market. So that's why last year we managed to attract more than 20 billion US dollar investment from abroad. It is because of big market of Indonesia, many companies from Western Europe, United States, China, and India invested in Indonesia to tap the big market Indonesia. Last year, we import 7 million ton of wheat. It is certainly a very big market because Indonesia doesn't grow wheat. So I told Bulgarian businessmen, it is big market. If you can grow wheat, yeah. And then finally I got information from Bulgarian that Bulgaria only produce less than 5 million ton of wheat. Yeah. So I cannot, I don't know whether, but I believe your farm is fertile. Yeah, it is good to grow wheat and also other product. We also import, last year we import 2 million ton of soybeans. On the other hand, we export a lot of palm oil to other countries, yeah, especially to China, India, and then to Western Europe also. And also rubber, cocoa, coffee. So if you are interested to do business in coffee and cocoa, just visit Indonesia. We still have a lot of production in cocoa and also palm oil. Thank you.
Your Excellency, how is the tourism developing?
Tourism is not so developed, I think. Yeah, with a population of 240 billion, we only able to attract 8 million foreign tourists. But domestic tourists is certainly big. Yeah, so most visitor to Bali is domestic tourists. Yeah, especially because we have a lot of holidays, so it is good for tourism also. By having a lot of tourism, also a lot of holidays, also produce economic development by promoting tourism. Thank you. Okay, nothing else? Okay. Thank you.
You mentioned that Bulgaria has fertile soils. I don't know how much you've traveled around our country, but a lot of our land just doesn't grow anything.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Do you have the same problem in Indonesia? Any unused land?
No, in Indonesia we grow rice and people work hard for producing rice, you know. Rice production is very intensive job. Yeah, so people doing growing rice from morning. They have to take care of water because rice is need a lot of water. And we always expanding our estate, including palm oil, coffee, cocoa, and we have planning, medium planning, that the next 5 years we will be, we already the biggest palm oil producers. And then the next 5 years, we hope we able to be biggest producer of cocoa. Yeah, that's our planning. Yeah. It is to fulfill the demand of cocoa in Western Europe and America also. Thank you.
You mentioned that Indonesia is really happy to have foreign investors. Are Indonesian businessmen interested in investing in other countries like Eastern Europe? I thought of this because it was said that, for example, Bulgaria has unused land, and also it's not only in Bulgaria, it's in other countries too. Are Indonesian business people interested in investing in these unused sources?
Yeah, several times I told the Bulgarian officials and businessmen that the problem is lack of knowledge of Indonesia about Bulgaria. So you have to do more promotion in Indonesia to attract businessmen, to attract tycoon in Indonesia to do business in Bulgaria. I always doing report every month. I'm doing report on development of economy in Bulgaria and also potential for economic cooperation. But I advise Bulgarian officials, you should send official delegation to Indonesia to convince Indonesian businessmen. It is not my job. My main job is to convince Bulgarian businessmen to invest in Indonesia. And that's our main job. So you see, even the Bulgaria potential is only small. There are several Bulgarian businessmen doing investment in Indonesia, in Central Java, in Bali, and in Lombok Island. So it is because of our intensive promotion in Bulgaria. So make them attracted to visit Indonesia, and then after they visited Indonesia, they interested in doing investment in Indonesia. So you need a lot of promotion in Indonesia to convince this one. Although in several occasions, only last month I met American businessmen, and then we talk about possible of cooperation between American businessmen and Indonesian businessmen doing joint venture in Bulgaria. But it is not our main job. It is a Bulgarian job to do promotion in Indonesia. Thank you. So, nothing? Okay. I think our growth is mainly because of foreign investment and domestic market, but not the challenge. Yeah. Since other countries in crisis, our export is going down. Yeah, because the market is also the demand is also reducing. So now. It is hard to maintain 6% growth. For this year, we expect between 5 to 6%. But mainly, we will continue to attract foreign investment in Indonesia, and also to promote domestic demands, including, for example, in holidays. Part of promoting domestic demand. And then besides that, democracy. Democracy also promoting domestic demand because by having election, there is demand for anything, for campaign and printing and also other activities. We actively organize international conference, such as this year we are going to organize UN civilization conference in Indonesia also. It is part of our promotion to maintain our high economic growth. It is also based on our bad experience. In 1999, we have economic crisis. That's because we were too confident in development, and then we borrow a lot of money from abroad, and then it crashed because of our borrowing is too big. And then based on this experience, we maintain our prudence economic policy with lower borrowing also, and also lower budget deficit. It is, thank you very much. All right, nothing, no more questions?
Questions, I would like to say thank you to His Excellency Sutomo, all the representatives of the Indonesian Embassy that helped this event happen, also the President's Office of AOBG, the Department of Politics and European Studies, student ambassadors who helped us with organizing the event, and also, of course, my colleagues at the OBG Political Science Club. Thank you.
This program is brought to you by AUBG Talks. For more, please visit us at aubg.edu/talks.